I'm not going to waste any time because I know that you all here in New York and around the world have been anxiously awaiting this conversation with Lloyd. So let's get going. First of all, I want to thank you for spending the summer with us. I have to tell you, we love it when you are here. You know, you add a spirit, a focus, keeps us all on our toes. You ask us questions like, why are you doing what you do in your life? So it's really an opportunity for all of us to, you know, understand what it's going to mean to have the best and the brightest going forward. What we've asked Lloyd to share with us in a number of different areas is advice. I know personally from time to time I go and I get advice, sit in a comfortable, casual chair, chat away with Lloyd. And so you're going to have an opportunity to do that this morning.
Edith, what's
well.
It like getting advice from Lloyd?
I want to start with a quote from LaGuardia Community College. Lloyd gave the commencement address a few weeks back, and you said, "Ambition is your inner voice that tells you you can and should strive to go beyond your circumstances or station in life." So I want to start with your story because, you know, you grew up in East New York in Brooklyn, went to Thomas Jefferson High School, you know, father a postal worker, mom a receptionist at a company, Harvard College, law school, law firm, sales, CEO of Goldman Sachs. How does that all connect together? Did you have ambition to be the CEO of Goldman Sachs?
What's Goldman Sachs? That's, I mean, nobody would have had that. But I think, look, I realize, you know, look at the crowd I'm talking to. When I look out and see this, you know, group of people, and people come from all over the country, and countries all over the world, and you know, it's like a lot of things. You could draw a straight line from where somebody started to where they are now because you have 2 points, but you could never have drawn that line just knowing where somebody started because there's an infinite ways and ways things are go. So if you see somebody here, you know they're started, and it seems so natural that they would have evolved in that direction because you have that straight line you can join. Yet things have been so unlikely, if you thought about it, for like a very high percentage of the people who come to this place. You know, the thing about, you know, you look back and you look around, you look at people who did well at Wall Street. You know, my predecessor, you know, grew up in the, you know, in a, you know, farm in the Midwest, as did, you know, that was Hank and John Corzine, similarly. And if you look at the backgrounds of people, you look at the people who make it in this country and where they started and go through the list of on any list of success, by however you measure success, whether it's, you know, the richest people in the country or the most successful, the list of CEOs or this, and you see that people are mostly strivers because this is a place where, you know, in this land, growing up in a, you know, with the advantages and carry burdens to it. Mm-hmm. And the people who very well, you know, very often do the best are the people who got to the place having been strivers and having worked the hardest and having learned the process of needing to work the hardest.
So what did you strive for? You went to law school, you're at a law firm. Why didn't you just stay in law? What was it about this industry that you found interesting enough to make that change?
Well, I didn't know. I'd worked and was mostly driven at that point by the need to pay back student loans. You know, you get out of school, and if you didn't get it, you know, there was no tour of the world that you could take. 9 months after you got out of school, your loans became due. And so, you know, in my case, when you got out of college, went right to law school. People don't do that now. You know, they take a couple of years off. And, you know, who's to say that's not for the better? Because if I had taken a couple of years off, I might have saved myself 3 years of law school and 5 years of practicing law. Because I might have focused a little bit more on what I might have done. But I will say that as, you know, when I was in the law, which, by the way, I liked. I didn't dislike being a lawyer. I kind of liked it. But, you know, I was doing litigation. Litigation, to some extent, means you're trying matters that occurred in the past, where the facts were in the past. And so you're looking back at a case, and I was, you know, working. And no matter what, and so I was living in 1979. I was living in facts that were 1968. Because that's what people were fighting over. And whatever happened at the end of the night, so if I worked late at night, if it was, you know, 1 a.m. when I stopped because I needed something to do, I'd put my pen down, the books would all be open, and the next day I'd come back, and I'd pick up exactly where I left off. The books would be open to the same page. Wherever I put the pen down, the pen was down. Wherever it trailed off, it was the same thing. When I left at night, I'd come back in the morning, time had passed in between, but nothing on my priorities changed. Then I got exposed to this industry, where no matter what you're working on today, and no matter what you think your priorities are tomorrow, odds are that they're going to all be reordered the next day. Because if you're in the trade, you know, if you're in the trading world, somebody would have sneezed overnight, and you know, the yen would rise or fall. Somebody would say something. Some policy would shift. There was some economic development that had repercussions through all the economies, and the next day you'd have to adjust to that. And if you were on the, you know, corporate side of the business, somebody would have made a bid for somebody. The other companies have to respond to it. People had to finance it, run around, and so whatever you thought your priorities were yesterday, it might be the same the next day, but chances are something would have intervened that would have reordered things, and I found that just more interesting and exciting. Even if I didn't always like the direction it took, I thought it was a more interesting kind of a lifestyle.
So you mentioned sometimes you didn't like the direction it took, and so you're the CEO now. Was it a straight line? Were there times where you were kind of pushed back to move forward, and how'd you deal with that? Give us an example.
Well. You know, I don't know what you're, when you say push back to get forward, I don't always, look, there's aspects of what I do that are a lot of fun. And even some things that are fun carry some anxiety to it. I mean, everybody here, you're starting out, so I know a very high percentage of the time you're walking into the room, and instead of thinking, what's this going to be like, you're thinking, gee, what are they thinking about me? You know, everybody carries with him or her some insecurities, or else we wouldn't have propelled ourselves to this place if we weren't battling and you know, again, striving to overcome and reacting to, you know, uncertainty and, you know, insecurity like that. And so I have times that I really enjoy, times when I'm stretched. And I know how it must seem, because it wasn't, you know, it only seems like a blink ago that I was sitting where you're sitting and John Weinberg, who was the CEO of the firm when I was there, who seemed so remote and so much older and so, you know, so, you know, important and, if not perfect, then well-developed, looked to me, and it's hard to conceive, but, you know, we all are stretched, no matter who you think of in the country that's doing something, and even if the situation didn't, even if the level of the people you're dealing with don't compel, just the uncertainty about the future and the weight of having to make decisions that have consequence that could be right or wrong carries it with some burdens. And then there's the fact that not everything I do even has the potential of being fun, because, you know, we're living, you know, just think of a lot of the aspects of the last few years when you have to work your way through legacy issues that are hard, but even more than hard, they're unpleasant, and you have to confront things and deal and respond to people who aren't happy with you and walk into rooms and deal with the consequences of that. And at that point, you're not on the fun, not fun axis. Do you meet your responsibilities or don't you access? And that's important too.
You know, we're in the talent business. People are our number one asset. And so you and I, Lloyd, often chat about, you know, the experience of having kids. Our kids are at about the same age, either just starting university or graduating. And do us a favor, like, don't text our kids right away if you happen
your
to know
them. Her oldest kid's same age as my youngest kids.
Right. And so, but is it so different for them starting out in their career? And, you know.
Look, it's a different time. And my kids are in a different place than I am.
Right.
So, and I don't know what's what.
Right.
Because I don't have that controlled experiment that puts them exactly in the same context I was in, only scroll 35 years forward, versus whether it's just that, whether, you know, so I don't know whether it's we that changed or the context in which they grew up versus me.
Is Goldman Sachs as interesting now as an opportunity as it was?
I think my own view, and again, you'll have your own perspective. Nothing in my life positions me to get this right more than you'd get it right, so it's just opinion. But from my, except that I've lived through another period and you can only read about it, is that I think things have never been more exciting, more interesting, and more accessible. You know, people say, oh my goodness, all the good ideas are gone, look at what people, I mean, look at how the world favors a kid who wants to be an entrepreneur today. You can go online and get immediate access. You know, you still have to do a good job. All everything does is give you access, but there's access to, you can have access to financing to present a case. You have access to infrastructure. Now versus 10 years ago, you don't need, you know, to start something, you don't need $5 million. You could start something with $50,000 because you can gain access to infrastructure, machines, and servers, and elements like that. You have, in the careers, there was nobody who would start out as a new professional. You know, in other words, people here think they're doing kind of mundane things early, but almost everything you do is like adding to your education here, even if it's a drag and even if it's mundane. The fact of the matter is, you'll keep doing it until you get so good at it that it's just so implicit. The things that take you a week now will take the inflection of an eyebrow a year from now, because you're so good at that, and that's a foundation for them going forward. But you're not really wasting your time at any point. Mm. When I was starting out, and she was started later than me, we weren't communicating by email. We were communicating by telexes, which were ribbons that somebody would type out, which 1 cent couldn't be pulled back. They'd be scrolling through a machine, almost like an old-fashioned ticker. And I'd spend 3 hours a day proofreading it.
I recall that, yeah.
Proofreading it, and I'm saying, did that make me a better, stronger person? And, you know, there's just so many things that are different. The world's a bigger world. You know, we're talking about John Weinberg, who was a great, you know, icon of this industry and a great man and a good, you know, and a great boss. But I was in China last week. John Weinberg never went to China on business. And I'm talking about John L. Weinberg, not John S. Weinberg, who I know you know, who's in the firm today. He didn't go to China 4 times a year. He didn't go to China at all. And he didn't go to Russia.
Right.
In the course of his business life. In other words, so here's another thing. The world is bigger. Because if you're Hugh Goldman Sachs in those days, you had to take the occasional trip to LA and Chicago. But you didn't go, your product, who you were, wasn't instantaneously as accessible to the rest of the world as it is today. And so it's just bigger, more leverage, more important, and going back to the first thing I said, everything is much more consequential and important.
Right.
There's a lot less dross and scut work and a lot less, you spend a lot less time doing things that are irrelevant.
And so, given some of the things that you've mentioned, we're more global, there's less time doing things that aren't relevant, what do you think is important for someone who's starting out in the business, working at Goldman Sachs today as an analyst? What are the skills or the way of thinking that you found to be particularly important?
You know, here's something that, and then I'll just observe, that very often in life, you'll get a narrative and a story that really, and it's accepted and it's given and it's presented, by the way, in markets and in life, where people say things, but it's not really what they do. And sometimes you have to look at what's real as opposed to what people say.
Right.
In other words, if you answer that question most of the time here, people say, oh, really, you really have to focus and read the Wall Street Journal every day and be the kind of person who's interested in that. And then I think, well, my predecessor was a major in English literature. I was a history major. It wouldn't have occurred to me in a million years to go to Wall Street. I went to law. By the way, I didn't even do business law. I wasn't doing corporate law. I was doing, something in the entertainment space. Totally foreign for this. Other kids wanted to be firemen and ballerinas. I wanted to be an investment banker. No, it wasn't like that. One should think of these things, and I said this the other, it was quoted back to me, so I said this when I was last week in Sydney at some point, because someone asked me a question like this, and I said, to be successful in this firm or in life, any part of life, I think what you have to try to be, and by the way, successful, not economically successful, but successful to yourself, in other words, to be happy to some extent, you have to certainly know the content of your business and your focus. And it's very important to have focus. And I don't doubt that you get a lot of information and advice on the focus part, because that's what everybody thinks is the only thing you have to do. But I think you also have to be, and maybe this is even more important at the end of the day, you also have to be a complete person. You have to be interesting. You have to have interest away from the narrow thing of what you do. You have to be somebody who's interesting to yourself, but you have to be somebody who somebody else wants to talk to. And you know, people in these jobs and things like that, you don't get locked up in a carrel, you know, chained to a desk, fed, you know, food under the door, just churning out spreadsheets. Nobody's gonna ask you to churn out this spreadsheet even if you're good at it. You have to be a complete person. And I think the order of things should be in your early life and your earliest part, like college, I think it should be for becoming a complete person. And then get more and more focused. You don't wanna start out focus now and get narrow from there. Now's the time when you should, you know, people I think should take, and I know it doesn't feel like that. In other words, and by the way, your big brother or sister in this firm may not say that to you, but look at what really they did. Look who they are. In other words, if you want to look at who's successful in the firm or in any other firm, go through that and really look at who they were. And sometimes this comes up to me in a lot of contexts. Somebody will say, oh my goodness, let's go. I want to be a 2-year analyst at Goldman, then 2 years at a private equity firm, going to go to and do that. And I said, because that's the mantra and that's the protocol and that's the thing. And I said, by the way, those people who you want to emulate in the world, who are those successful people who are going to hire you for that 2-year, what did they do? That's not what they did. Some of them were in government for 15 years. Some of them worked at Goldman Sachs for 20 years and really became very, very adept at something before they went, but they didn't do what they're saying, and they're not lying to you. If you slap the lie detector on them, they'd be telling, it's just not the narrative. I think you have to be more, I riffed on this in another context, I know some people saw it. I like to read history, and I like to read the biographies part of history, because I like to know what people really did that get it, because you'd find that nobody took that kind of a straight line. And so when people hear and worry, oh my God, I'm getting out of college already and I don't know how to discount a cash flow. I mean, I promise you, if you're here for 15 minutes, you'll know how to do that. And having studied it in college for 4 years, and then having your 15 minutes here learning it won't make you know it more. And 6 months after you're here, no one will remember who did it. But if you have a more breadthy kind of an academic career where you learn more stuff and you're more interesting and you read a Shakespeare play and you took an art course, that's going to serve you well, not just in your personal life, in your business life, you should be a more interesting person.
So, you know, I have to add to that a little bit. You know, Lloyd and I, pretty different, right? I mean, although we both grew up in Brooklyn, right? We both went to Harvard. We are both sitting here at Goldman Sachs today. We're pretty different, but in some ways the same, right? Because we found opportunities that have kept us engaged. Differences are really important to our business. Look around the world. We've got screens of all of our analysts. So difference is very powerful and important to our franchise, to our clients, because our clients aren't all the same. And you look around this room, Lloyd, I don't know about you, I'm struck by the fact that, you know, we've got men, women, you know, ethnically different folks. How do you think about the importance of that as you rise through the organization? How are we doing on that front? And
you know, if I saw a group and it was all, and it didn't look like a cross-section, it would look so strange to me now.
I agree, right?
I mean, that happened to me where I looked at I went to a country which was a very, homogeneous country, and it just looked odd to me talking to the room. Let me tell you, no one's had a perfect record. Maybe no one's had a great record. But if you're comparing, this industry has all good reasons for wanting to be out front because of course, where we perform and who we have to be effective with, and the meritocratic nature of it. So I think it's hugely important. The only feedstock that we have for our industry, you know, if you're in the energy business, you know, or extracting business, you take in iron ore and you spit out aluminum on the other end, you apply it. We just have people. That's the only feed, you know, the only real bulky expense of Goldman Sachs are the cost of the people. And the next thing, which is way, way lower, is the cost of the buildings we put the people in. Other than that, there's no, you know, we don't have factories or raw materials or inventories of physical stuff, by and large. And so, that has to be the most, that has to be the most important thing to us.
So I know you guys are waiting to ask questions, but I just have one other follow-up from what you just said, Lloyd. I joined the management committee in the spring of 2008, and let's just say things got interesting from there. And one of the things that was most striking to me is that in those management committee meetings, we meet every Monday at 8:15, and was that they took on the same pattern, right? We heard from our CFO, and then Lloyd would share some thoughts. So on those Sundays, in the thick of the crisis, and you were thinking about, okay, you know, management committee tomorrow morning, what was on your mind? What were your biggest concerns? What was most important to you to share with us in that time period? And what were you expecting from the people of Goldman Sachs?
Look, I would say I didn't think of management committee as something that I prepare for. I think of that as, and you know, let me just explain. People don't know that, you know, we have a group of numbering in the high 20s senior right. people. It's a very big firm. So you say, oh my goodness, high 20s, that's so many people. But just think of the breadth of our operations. We have people in every division, in every corner of the world, and including people who help operate the firm are important to hear from. So I look at that as an opportunity for the most senior tranche of the firm to get together and be real partners. Talk about what they're doing, what they're seeing, what they're anxious about, what they're, you know, where they're worried, where they feel good, and to go around the table. And as a result of that experience, everybody learns everything. By the way, the firm as a whole, if I had to say one of the characteristics of Goldman Sachs that's differentiated here, everybody knows everything.
Or, exactly
or
right.
feels entitled, or by the way, feels entitled to know everything. It started with the difference in a partnership. In a partnership, and then will remind me of the question because I'm going off track here.
Okay.
In a partnership, people are mutual agents for each other. In a normal employee-employer situation, there's somebody's working for someone else, but in a partnership, there are aspects to that, but there's also mutual agency. So a senior partner of a firm is different from a CEO of a firm, even though we use those terms interchangeably, because we've only been a corporation, a company for 14 years, and so the bulk of my career was as when the firm was a private partnership. And what was the difference between a job that Hank Paulson would have when he was the senior partner versus the job he had when we went public? Well, that's what, no difference here, but in another form of organization would be very different. So when I talk out to my partners like this, on the one hand, they work for me because I'm senior on the letterhead. That's very corporate-like. But on the other hand, they're also the owners of the business, and I work for them. And I'm there by their consent. They don't owe their position to me. I owe my position to them. And it's sort of contractual and mutual agency. And that's really what the definition of a partnership is. Literally, the definition of a partnership is mutual agency, different from a corporate structure. And as a result of that predicate, everybody here has a much higher, in the firm, has a much higher sense of entitlement about what the senior people and the manager of the firm owes to them, not just the other way around. And I wouldn't have it any other way. That's how you get strong people who are knowledgeable, who make decisions in terms of what's the right thing to do and what makes sense, as opposed to what does my immediate boss think I should be thinking of, because people know more and feel entitled to know more, and that's, in a way, the culture of the firm.
Salt Lake City, there's a question.
Hi, Mr. Blankfein. Thank you for joining us today. It is frequently cited that you grew up in the projects of Brooklyn. How has this upbringing shaped your perspective of money, power, and the world? Thank you.
Well, what I was saying is, and I tell you, I know I read those stories, and I know they're interesting, and it's important to tell them, but, you know, I'm not that comfortable with the whole, you know, the old rail splitter walking 3 miles to return a library book, like that whole thing, because it's really, because I talk to kids all the time who grew up in, you know, middle class or lower conditions in countries where there was no access, and somehow they, you know, had harder, much harder scrabble lives than I did, and who managed to get themselves into, you know, filled out an application, got themselves to an Ivy League school in the United States, and, you know, on and on and on, and had bigger families and had to compete for resources, you know, so it's, I think, you know, it's like a common story here, and it shapes, and I think it makes the culture of the firm better. This is not a place where that recruits entitled kids for their entitlement, and it's a place, and by the way, and I alluded to, there are advantages to growing up in a place where you have access to a lot of privileges, and there are burdens to that also. And the burdens of that are the insecurity that comes from having had things more easily.
Right.
That knowing and the confidence and with having achieved in the face of adversity should come a higher level of confidence. At the same time, and I can go back and forth in this, and so I think whoever you are and whatever your station, these are the cards you got dealt. And so you can't spend your time wringing your hands about it. You play the cards you have, and you accept the burdens of your of the context in which you came from, and enjoy the privileges, and don't be guilty about either one of them.
Here in New York.
Hi, Lloyd. Thanks for speaking to us today. So something you mentioned was becoming a complete person. And I know a lot of the interns kind of just see you, you know, as the CEO of Goldman Sachs. And I'm curious to see what else you do in your life that, you know, makes you a complete person, and then how you kind of stay grounded with all the responsibility that you have. Thank you.
Well, the easiest thing is wife and kids who don't, as much as I'd like them to get to respond to me as the CEO, they don't. So I go from the top of the totem pole to the lowest guy on the totem pole just by going home. So that keeps you grounded. I strive to get to the surface of the ground. That keeps you grounded. You also have to, you have these positions, and with these positions come enormous responsibility too, and you have to be, and it has to work out. You get grounded by circumstances. You have to try, the achievement, how they say graduation, commencement, this is not the end, it's just the beginning. When we do an IPO, we tell the company at the end, by the way, we're gonna stick with, this is not the end of the process, it's the start of your life as a public company. And when you get jobs like this, it's not the end in itself, it's not the goal. The goal is to be successful in the job and to be thought of well and to produce a good legacy and to leave the place stronger than when you found it. That's the thing, and that's not achieved by virtue of getting the title. That's something that weighs on me, like, doing a good job and your job weighs on you. And so that also keeps you grounded. I think an important thing that I remember that also keeps me is sometimes I look out, and you can be haughty about some position that you're in, but you remember that in the crowd of people that you talk, look, I look out at this group, and I alluded to this before about who you will be later on, and in this group are people who when it's time for you to take, when you age into a position of authority in the world, when your cohort moves up and dominates the world scene, there are people in this room, I don't know who you are or what you'll be. You don't know who you are or what you'll be. But I guarantee you there'll be people in this room right now that I'm talking to who are going to do very, very important things and will exceed, in contribution to the world what people on the stage will have done. And I'm conscious of that. And I think when I look out, I don't see people who I've risen above. I just see people who are younger than me. Some of you may, and so that's an important thing also to keep in mind. You don't know.
From London, there's a question.
Hi, Lloyd. I also do history, and I also very much enjoy biographies. So I would very much like to know sort of what do you do on a daily basis and sort of about your routine. You hear lots about that in biographies, and I thought that was very interesting.
Say it again, the last part again.
You hear lots in biographies about people's routines and what they do on a daily basis, etc. And I would like to hear about that.
This job is pretty consuming. And last week, I don't want to tell my sad story to you, but last week I was in China, and since I was so close, I stopped in on Sydney on the way back, which is only 11 hours away in the wrong direction. So it's not like, I spend a lot of time at this, and on Saturday I go to Europe again, and when I'm on the plane, you'd think I'm reading all those. See, people say, it goes back. People say things that are different than what they do. So I tell you how I like to read this stuff, but I'll tell you, when I'm on the plane, I'm reading my notes for the next meeting, the meetings I'm going to have. And if you look at what I do on the, you know, I go out and I like to, you know, run and laugh and jump with the other boys and girls and play golf and do all those things and talk to my kids and you know, lie on the couch. I sometimes pray for a rainy day so I don't feel guilty about just lying on a couch is what I really want to do. But come Sunday, I'm
back at it.
I'm Sunday, which, you know, and it may be, you know, depending on the time of year, the football game will be on, or I'm, you know, I'm doing it in the morning or in the early evening. I'm living my next week. I get big briefing books over the weekend with, you know, the meetings that I have and notes on it and who they are. And they may expect that I know something, and I will. And I do. And there's consequence. So it's not just window dressing. I'll get caught up. But that takes time, and I can't do that 5 minutes before I'm scheduled to see somebody because my day goes bump, 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 you know, go through. So on Sunday, I'll go through my week. I'll sit there and I'll go, okay, let me get through Monday, and I go through this and I read all the stuff, and then I remind myself during the week, but that takes a lot of time. Also, the weekend and off time is a time when people sort of like lining up for approvals. You know, anybody knows there's a lot of processes, commitments committee, credit committee, all these different things. Let me tell you, those committees are the last step in a long process because there's a lot of trial balloon and testing and socializing some things. So if somebody has a, you know, kind of a hairy situation or a context of where they're worried about whether we should do this or not or whether it get approved or not, you're working on that long memo now at this stage of your career, which is very important. But in the course of that memo evolving, people are testing and trying out ideas. That's also happens a lot on the weekend. There's a lot of voicemail traffic back and forth. I'm thinking of doing this in this country with these people. This is a little sketchy because of this. We're taking a risk here. The client really wants us to do that. I'm not so sure. What should we, you know, advise? What business selection? Should we choose this client or that client to represent in an auction? You know, et cetera. And those things get socialized. Now, that's just a word. What does socialize mean? It means there's a lot of conversations and dialogue. And it's not like that's what you're doing. That's sort of, you're doing other things at the same time. But while you're out and about, the phone rings and somebody's running something by you. And you're sort of saying, well, you're not giving a final answer. This is kind of, you know, based on what you're saying, this is how I'm leaning, this is what I would think. And they go away and they develop the facts more. Or they go out and say, you better tell them that that's not, you know, they better adjust the facts to fit the bias, and that's also a process that's always happening in this firm, and that's also something that's kind of like a gray background noise of stuff that's going on in the firm, away from the crisp decision-making process that you observe and you prepare for. That's also going on. You get to be my, there's another element, you get to be my age, and your personal life and your business life kind of converge, so that, you know, you can't be doing what I'm doing and engaging with other business leaders, you know, business leaders and other things without becoming friends. And when I go out and socialize, there are people, just like you do with people that you're friendly with, I do with people who I engage with and some people you work with and help, and it's a crisp business relationship. It's not that sometimes you just like people and you go also develop a personal relationship with them, and sometimes somebody says, is that business or not? And I say, you know, hard to figure out. Because I'm talking about, I have business, converging business interests with people, and I also have, and they're also my social friends at this stage, because that's just the way it is. You go through times of your life, and most of the people you're friends with, most of the new friends you make, are kids, you know, other kids that go to school with you, and then it's people you work with, and then it's parents of the kids who your kids are going to school with. And then you get to another stage of life, and it's your business relationships, because that's what's filling up your plate.
You know, and just to add something to that, you know, I've been on the other side of the get Lloyd information on a Friday, pick up the BlackBerry on a Saturday. He's asking a question about something we're doing in recruiting or in the development space, et cetera. And, you know, sometimes my kids are like, do you ever stop? And I actually don't think about it that way because this is such a significant part of my life in a really positive way. It's not like I'm sitting, you know, like the old days, you know, you're waiting for your FedEx package to arrive and you have to go through the papers, et cetera. You can just kind of come in and out of it. But when you're doing something that you enjoy, where you're really believing that you make an impact, it's a cool thing when Lloyd sends a email on the weekend wanting to know more about what you do.
Or you read something in the paper and you say, gosh, is that going to affect us?
Exactly, exactly. And therefore, I in turn turn to folks who are experts in the area and ask them, and although they probably would prefer not to be, you know, in the middle of it for a second, then they get really inspired because it's recognized that what they're doing is really, it matters, and it's connected to what's going on in the world. It's pretty powerful. Let's, other questions.
On a lifestyle basis, too, because you're interested in that, a lot of this stuff just becomes background, you know, stuff
yes.
that you're just doing. So if somebody said to you, how much time do you spend listening to music? You give them an answer, but then the amount of time you spend doing stuff would add up to more than 100%. Because while you're listening to music, you're doing other things. So you're not just listening to music. You're not staring at the speaker listening to music. You're listening to music and doing something else. Or did you watch the football game yesterday? Yes. But while you were doing that, you were doing something else and something else and picking your head up when it got noisy on the TV. And so a lot of this stuff is just stuff that you're also people say multitasking, but you just really, I think of it as kind of the white noise in the background of
right.
your life.
Right. Coming back here, yes.
So I'm working in the legal department. I'm a rising junior at Cornell. Wanted to ask two questions. First for you, Lloyd, you mentioned that the financial industry is one that's very volatile, and most of the issues that you're confronted with are often intertwined. Can you talk about some of the issues that most worry you about the future of this industry or of this firm?
Just from the broad to the narrow, this industry, the reason why finance is volatile and everything, just think of what we do. Our business is trying to guess the future. We're trying to figure out which industries to fund, what's going to make it, which companies with the industry are going to succeed and which not. And then we're making investments on that basis and encouraging other people to. And sometimes, guess what? You might be wrong. And so then you get second guess for it. Why did you do that? Why did you think the industry would be restructured this way? And why did you gear your advice to having these industries run into each other and merge and not that? You know, and also just think in our sales and trading, we're also trying to guess the next price of things, not the current price, but where the price is going to be. And this business of guessing the future is a very volatile thing, and you have to make rapid adjustments. That's why it's volatile, and it's also volatile because people sometimes think that you know more than they do, and sometimes they even think you know the future when all you are is just the most rapid responder to change. And so that creates the context in which you have volatility, and what I worry about more specifically is, you worry about being wrong, you worry about a big risk that you don't know about, you worry about things outside your control. But, I worry most, what I worry, what the most danger is that 30,000 people have to work together for a very long time to create a great reputation for the firm, and any one of those 30,000 people on his or her own can kill it. In a second, that's a very big exposure, and which is why we spend so much time. And you've seen it now. Killing it is a little too strong because you don't kill it, but you certainly can undo the good work. The individual can undo the good work of the many, and that's a big source of worry and concern.
So we're running out of time, and I just want to conclude by thanking you again for the work that you've done for the firm this summer. You keep us on our toes, and we're excited about the potential of having as many of you as possible return. But Lloyd, do you want to just close with one piece of advice? People want advice from you. They're going to be going forth, and you want them to think, God, that was Lloyd. I got that piece of advice.
Now the bar is up here.
Go for it.
I would say we tend to, cultivate, the flip side of, the concomitant of ambition. Is focus and intensity. I would say people at the age of the people in this room could also relax a little bit too. Life is very unpredictable and uncertainty, and it's good to have your ears open for opportunity, and you don't really know yet what business is like or this industry is like or that firm, but you don't really know, and importantly also, you don't know yourselves. And so I'd be a little less concerned of where I should be at this time and what kind of skills I should come out of college with. And I thought by now I'd surely be on the Supreme Court, having gone to Harvard Law School and practiced in a law firm. It didn't work out that way. And that exceptional situation is not the exception, it's the rule. And so I think you should, it doesn't relieve you from the pressure of trying to get it right as soon as possible, right out of the dorm room. And there'll be stories of people who do, but it's very unlikely that you will. and not highly consequential if you don't get it right away. And in fact, those will fuel your stories when you're sitting here talking to someone else. And it'll make you a richer, you know, well-rounded person anyway. So I would say, I would advise you all to, you know, work hard, try to get it right, and be a little less anxious. You'll be better. It's like in, I came to golf late, and it's stupid. Anybody who saw me play would be really weirded out that I'd use a golf metaphor because I'm so bad. But they always tell you, if you hold the club tight, it won't go as far or go as straight. And if you're loose and your hands are like strings, it'll whip around and go faster. So less energy is actually more. Loose is better than a hard grip. And I think that applies to your careers and your life too. If you're loose and comfortable, you may not only be happier, you may actually be more successful than if you're more focused and tightly wound about things. So lighten up.
Thank you, Lloyd.
Okay.